Let my people go.
The Lord of hosts will do battle for us.
Brothers and sisters, how are you guys doing? I love you, I miss you, and I just wanted to make a video and go over some of the notes I have in my notebook. The dreams and visions are starting to kind of pile up a little bit, so sometimes I may have to kind of get through some of them kind of quick. And forgive me for not being a very good speaker. I like to be able to communicate what I'm seeing better with you guys, because it would truly blow your mind, and I know I'm not doing it any justice, but all I can do is my best, you know. But this first event was, I mean the first event, this dream was really good. It started off sad. It started off sad because in this dream, there was this huge thing about to take place, some royalty inheritance. It was like an event, you know? It seemed like it was not only on the earth, but it seemed like it was throughout the universe, or maybe in a lot of different realms. So the whole thing about this event was you had to be royal and you had to have an inheritance, but the fathers would go and they'd have their child. And so when I was sat in this dream thinking about how I didn't have a father, you know what they do, brothers and sisters, like I'm trying to say this dream the best of my ability. They have a horse. Their son would sit on the back of the horse, that one, you know, who they're trying to give an inheritance to. And then the father would be out in the front, whoever father it was that was getting the inheritance, they would get out in front and they would like walk your horse, you know? And so when they walk this horse, I knew that they did this all over, you know? I don't know if it's all over the galaxy or all over all that the father has created, all the realms. I'm not sure where we were going, but we kept on going to all these different places. Now, the part that was really cool for me is this, you know, the father reminded me, or somebody did in this dream, that I didn't have a father, earthly dad. And so when it came time for me to get my inheritance, I was in my mind thinking, wow, you know, I don't have a dad. But as soon as I thought that, brothers and sisters, you know, bam, there's the father. Father comes into this dream, brothers and sisters, and in this dream, he takes a hold of the horse, you know, the rope. And he tells me that he is, pretty much just tells me he's my father and that he's going to walk me and do this whole inheritance event thing with him, you know, that God's going to be there to be my father. And that was really awesome. I guess you could say he kind of adopted me in this dream. The father did, and I know that he would do the same for any of you. He loves all you guys so much, and you are all sons and daughters of God. You guys know, I always end my videos with that little end clip about being a royal priesthood. I always remember, brothers and sisters, that you guys are royal sons and daughters of the Most High God. The next thing that I'm going to share with you guys is about 2 days ago, I was getting up to go use the bathroom and I started to have a flash vision as I was going to use the bathroom. I started to see a bunch of kids. When I say kids, I mean like 21 to 25 years old. They were running and saying, get in the truck, trying to get everybody into this truck they had. And they were all getting into the back of this truck. And there was just a sense of urgency, you know, come on, everybody get in the truck. And brothers and sisters, I think I even heard that so I would have something to tell you guys about how short we are on time. I'm surprised we're still here, brothers and sisters, but the Bible says it's sooner than everyone thinks. But I tell you this, I really do think that it's about to take place. And I plead with all of you to give all of your heart to the Lord. You know, start working for the Lord, brothers and sisters. Help communicate with others about how close we are to the rapture taking place. This next vision I had, I'm not sure what to think about it. And I'll tell you first. It was you know how in the movies, I don't go to the movies no more. I don't even have, I have a TV, but I don't have cable and like that. I don't need it. But I do have my internet. And so, you know how if you ever watched that old Superman movie when it came out, how they can go and see kind of how they put clothes on a mannequin? You gotta be kidding me. That train's going off again when I'm making a video. And it never does, it seems, until I'm making a video. Wow. What was I saying? Oh, yeah. You know how they have that Superman suit and then he has the S on it and all that? Well, okay, so in my vision, I see it's kind of like a closet opening and I see a bunch of light come on and then I see a Superman costume appear. There was nobody in the outfit. I just saw a light and then a Superman. But I gotta say this, I don't think it was good. You know, I think it was the enemy, you know. When I was young, I used to like watching Superman and all that. And I think that was the enemy trying to be slick there, you know, knowing that I used to like watching Superman and I kind of liked it as a kid and all that, you know. But we know now that the Supermen are going to be a lot of the Nephilim, brothers and sisters, the hybrids. And I, now that I think about it, I think that he was trying to entice me, you know, like make you a Superman. But I don't need that. No, my answer will always be no to evil. And like many of you, I will keep striving day by day to grow even closer to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He loves you guys so much. I know a lot of you guys are doubting. A lot of you guys are can be at bad places in your life. But if you just hold off, you know, have that faith. Remember, Jesus says, you know, if he protects the birds, so how much more would he protect you? And I never realized this until a few years back, that even when you're sitting there talking, he's listening to everything you're saying. He can see everything. He can listen to everything. And so, brothers and sisters, even when you're praying and you're thinking he's not hearing you, he hears you. He hears you. And he loves you. The next thing that I'm going to share, I have a few dreams that I haven't wrote them all out yet on paper. I have them in my voice, my phone, you know, my voice memo. And so what I'm going to do is, sometimes they're really long. It will take me pages to fill up. And so I might just take a few things from here and there and kind of tell you guys about that and maybe share the whole dream on another day. But I was in this one dream, and I overheard these two people talking to each other. And while standing in the bathroom, I had took a shower and this kind of stuff, I started to hear audibles when I was in this bathroom. You know, sometimes bathrooms symbolize cleansing and, you know, cleaning and stuff like that. I'm in this bathroom and I'm hearing somebody talk. They asked where I was. And then I hear some people talking and I hear them say with my ears, I hear, "The greatest is among you." And that's what I heard. And so I'm not going to make any type of, you know, I don't know why I heard that. And I just thought I'd share it with you guys. And by no means am I saying I'm the greatest in the world. So please, if you took it that way, then, you know, you're probably not going to like this channel because, you know, a lot of the stuff I get is a lot of personal stuff. And I do get a lot of stuff for you guys as well. But I notice with my more personal stuff, I have people that maybe get upset with me whenever I get a blessing. You know, but I'm not going to apologize for serving the Lord. I'm not going to apologize for being blessed. You know, I'm nothing but a worm in this life. But guess what? All my treasures are laid up in store for heaven. Just like I know that most of you too have your treasures laid up in heaven. I live in something that looks like a shed RV in this little bitty looking thing. But I've never found more peace and happiness in my life until I just fully all out surrendered my heart to Jesus Christ. And when I did that, brothers and sisters, it's true what he says. He makes you a new creation. I was having a vision of being given a ring. Now, this guy picked up a big ring. It was mostly green. I think I saw gold. It was gold on the outside, but it glowed with this beautiful green color. And that's the color that I'm associated with. Yes, that's the color that Raphael's associated with, you know, green. And so he raises it up and he's asking me if it's mine. And then I see on it, I'm like, yes, that's my ring. And I went to get my ring and it had rank one on the ring, which I thought was pretty cool. And it was, he's being given it to me. And he's like, "This your ring?" I was like, "Yeah, that's my ring." And I went and got it and it was beautiful. Do you guys remember a while back, I was telling you that I remember listening to a video, and this video, it was like extra biblical books, you know, but it was audio where I could listen to it on my phone, put my earphones on and just kind of listen to it and relax. And I told you guys that they were burying the body of Moses. And this is what was in one of these extra biblical books. And as they were burying Moses, one of the seven archangels was missing. And I told you guys that a missing angel was Raphael. And I couldn't find it to give you guys the proof, but I will put up a picture now, if I can remember. I'd be terrible if you guys are looking and I forgot to do it. Here we are just looking at, I took a picture of something I was reading, and it backed up what I remember listening to. It says, one of the seven archangels, it says, Raphael is one of the seven archangels who brings prayers before God, he's in Tobit. It says, although he was not one of the six who buried Moses. And it gives some listings here. I don't know what that stands for, maybe Targum or something in Deuteronomy. And it says that he is the second of the six. What this is trying to say, brothers and sisters, is like I had told you, when I read, and I'll show you guys another one. I'll pull up real fast while I have you guys just kind of waiting on me here. So I'm kind of reminding myself to put that other picture up so you guys can see that one too. It's a newspaper clipping, I think it is. And it says the same thing. Do you know the reason why, out of the seven archangels, why Raphael was the only one who didn't go? Because he was Moses. I'm sure all of you who have been here for a long time know this already, but, you know, it's actually, they have it in scripture. I know it's not, it's extra biblical, I believe, but where, or maybe it's not even extra biblical. I'm not sure where it comes from, but I just remember I used to listen to it on my earphones, you know, and play it, and all of a sudden, it just disappears. I don't see it no more. But then here I am again finding remnants of it, you know, it's like little bitty remnants of what I was trying to tell you guys about. That the reason why that Raphael wasn't there when all the other angels had to be there is because Moses was the was Raphael. So it's kind of like you see that all six of them are there except for Raphael. You know, you could tell that all the arcs were there present, you know what I mean? So the only reason that Raphael probably wouldn't be there as well is because he was because his spirit was the one in Moses, you know. So I just think that's fascinating, and I know it's true without a shadow of a doubt. I could keep you guys here for days with all the dreams and visions of confirmations he's given me. I had another experience to where I heard a still small voice speak to me, and it just said my name, well, my angelic name, but it was so weird. And I just knew it was from the Lord, though. You guys know how our Savior is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords? Well, I heard a voice, that still small voice, but it wasn't audible now. Like, I could, like, you know, I'm being told something, and I was called Lord Raphael. I'm not even joking. I'm not making that up. That's what I heard. I heard Lord Raphael. Then I thought to myself, I was just worried about, you know, like, is this bad or is this good? But then I started to think about it. Well, our Savior is the Lord of Lords, you know? So he's already told me my position and rank, angel of authority, fourth in command, you know? So if Jesus is the Lord of Lords, you know, I don't know, brothers and sisters. I just think maybe it might be a title. I'm not sure, but I just really was shocked to hear that, you know? The next flash of vision is a pretty simple one. I started to see green smoke. Now, you guys know that I've also had some others with smoke as well. The Lord had his wings covering me, but I could still see the mountaintops. And, you know, he showed me that there was smoke just rising as he covered me with his wings. And so when I see smoke, because I know the Lord has already showed me a few times smoke from Mount Sinai, but the color green, you put them together, you get the green smoke. And I've been seeing a lot of stuff with smoke for some reason. And do you guys remember when I talked about the Phytanna agreement? I had a dream to where I was so worried about my mom's name, who is Angela, could mean angel, messenger of God. There were people, angels, like they were going into this house doing this Phytanna agreement. And I just knew it was evil. It was really, really bad, and that it was changing people's DNA. And I was so against it in the dream, like trying to get people not to take the Phytanna agreement. I'm not gonna get into all the details of it, but I had a sister who sent me, or a brother, I forgot if she was female or male, sent me a little something on it. And there actually is something that talks about a Phytanna agreement. Now, this is more from a company who is related to marijuana. I don't know what's going on there. It's Phytanna is America's farm-to-shelf cannabis brand, founded in 2015. Phytanna has established itself as a national cannabis brand with current expansion on a state-by-state basis where law permits. It goes on and on about this Phytanna. So I don't know if there's a match here. It might mean something totally different, or she might have kind of stumbled onto something. Who knows what they're putting in all these chemicals? I've been having vitamins on my mind a lot lately because, you know, who knows what they're putting in these vitamins? You should be seeing on your computer what I was just reading to you. I'm going to try to take a picture of it, and you guys can just see it on the computer, you know, on your screen when I'm talking about it. I'm reminded about this one reoccurring vision that I've had. There's this giant, brothers and sisters. He could be angel or giant, or Nephilim, I'm not sure. But he's in an underground cell. I don't know if he has too much hair either. Was he bald? I'm trying to remember. I don't think he was, but I don't think he had that much hair. And he's huge. I mean, this thing is sitting down its butt, and there's people crawling on him like the size of cockroaches, you know what I mean? Like crickets. So that's how small the people are compared to this guy. And he's like, I think he's chained up in a cell, and the people that were all around him were the ones kind of taking care of this thing. And he's just sitting on his butt in this dirty, rocky-looking cell. And I see the shackles, I see the people, how small they are. And I'm thinking to myself, is this the fallen angels? Is this a Nephilim being held down? Is that somebody like the fallen Azazel? You know, who is that guy? I'm not sure, but it is reoccurring. And I see this guy in a jail cell with chains and shackles. And he's just sitting down while little people crawl all over him. So I'm not too sure about that one. The next thing I'm going to share with you guys is one to where I'm not sure what was going on, but I think we're actually, like I always tell you guys, that we're working in the spirit sometimes. Like I got a little sleep last night, but I didn't have any dreams. Well, did I have any dreams? I don't remember if I did, because I was just out. You know, I haven't slept a lot. And so all I heard the other day was, Moses has defeated us. So I heard the fallen talking. I don't remember if it was in a dream, you know, not last night, but the day or two before that, I heard them say, or somebody say, Moses has defeated us. So I'm thinking to myself, so I'm in a war right now? And of course we're in a war in the spirit, you know? And so I'm thinking to myself, well, man, when I go to sleep, my spirit must be working hard, you know, and behind the veil. Makes you think, brothers and sisters, a lot of us are being called to work on the other side of that veil. Now, I know I repeat myself sometimes, but I have to, you know, let everybody else know who's new to the channel. You know, one time I was called up to heaven, and I was like, what am I doing here? And the angel said, sometimes the Lord will take a secondary group of extraordinary people up to heaven to help when needed, you know. And I saw the angel turn into its true form. And, you know, so some of us do work when we're sleeping. You're not just laying there, I don't think, anyway. You know, if you're part of that group, then you're going to be doing stuff in the spirit and serving the Lord to the best of your ability. I made a kind of cool little connection to something that backed up what I had saw. Okay, so I was listening to something the other day, and it said that the enemy was cast out of the sixth heaven. And I was like, boom, confirmation to myself. I'm not going to get into all the details of it, but do you guys remember? Well, you're not going to remember that probably, but I had this vision. It was the heaven vision, or I was there, one of the two. It's really hard to tell when they're that vivid. And I was talking to Jesus and everything, and we were shooting the bows, bow and arrows, and I was kind of shooting the arrows in front of him, making his path straight. And as I did that, that's when I said the word archangel, two other archangels popped up and said, here we are. And so I'm talking to them. Now, if you remember, in the Bible, it talks about Peter, James, and John being the three pillars. So all of a sudden, I'm in heaven with Jesus, and at some point in this dream, they have these glasses they put on. When they put these glasses on, they can see any level of heaven they want. And I just noticed that there were seven. And I said, I have one. They said, yeah, you have one too. And whenever they would put these glasses on, like I said, they turn into pillars. And so when I turned into one, I was looking down and I saw that everything was at peace except for in the sixth heaven, that there was war in the sixth heaven. And you guys also know that I've talked about how my new name was Jacob. You know, that's kind of a new name the Lord had given me because of its meaning. And so he was, one time I heard, the mist of the tents have fallen into Jacob's hands. The mist of the tents have fallen into Jacob's hands. Okay, so before that, he had told me that he gave me those glasses where I could see all. If just to go back for a second, Peter, James, and John, the three pillars, there were three of us. Peter, James, John. I was the third pillar. I was standing there, so that was another confirmation. Peter, James, and John. So whoever the Peter was, he had his glasses on. James had his on. And it's like, so some of these people were angels, brothers and sisters. And then whenever there was that war, only in the sixth heaven, I said, always at peace, always well, except for the sixth heaven. So whenever they said, the mist of the tents have fallen into Jacob's hands, that was telling me that there's war, and there's only one war happening in this sixth heaven. And then I was like, okay, so the mist of the tents have fallen into Jacob's hands. You know, there's only one war, and that's the sixth heaven. And then the other day I'm listening, and it said that this guy, I don't know how he knows that or anything, you know, but he's like, yeah, you know, he was kicked out of the sixth heaven. When I heard it, I was like, boom, confirmation. That's just, of course he's getting kicked out from the sixth heaven. Why? What does the Lord call me now? He calls me Jacob now, which means supplanter. So he is getting, his forces are getting their behinds handed to them, and they're getting kicked out. You know, so I don't know what's going on now. When I saw that, brothers and sisters, I don't know if they're still there, if they left. All I know is I heard Moses has defeated us a couple of days ago. And so, praise God, hallelujah. I don't know what I'm even doing, you know. We're all probably just working so hard for the Lord in the spirit world. No, I'm not talking about astro projecting or nothing like that. I'm talking about the Lord being able to take your spirit to heaven, or to wherever he needs you. Father can do that. There's nothing too hard for our God. He's a God of miracles. He's not just a God of natural means. He does use natural means, but he's a God of wonders. I had this one dream of playing cards, and I knew they were royal. I saw a king in the middle with a jack on one side of it, of the king, and a queen on the other side. And I'm not, you know, I'd like to hear your thoughts and opinions on what you think that means. I'm not going to give you my belief on this one, but I'll just go ahead and go to the next dream. I had a vision, and it was me and my female companion. I saw an island, when all of a sudden I see up in the air written the word soon. So God was telling me that soon, well, we'd be at this, or I'd be at this heavenly island, which I believe is the next step to what I do. There's just so much stuff going on, brothers and sisters, so many layers. You know, I got island, then I have to be back on a mission. And I think the heavenly island, though, is where we'll go get relaxed. We'll have time to learn and to listen to the Savior. And we'll take back the lessons we learned from that place, and some of us will come back and do missions on the earth. And I believe that the people over there are probably the 144,000 that are going to be at this island. Like I said, that's just my opinion, but it would make sense to me that the ones that are there training, getting ready to come back to the earth to do a job for the Father, I believe that it probably is the 144,000 and the two witnesses. This last vision I'm going to share is one to where I saw a bunch of vehicles up in the sky, and they were all getting ready to take off. All these vehicles just kind of floating in the air. We all can see that that's just symbolic of the rapture. Cars are transportation. So we're being transported out of here. That was the cute way of the Lord to let us know that we're about to be taken, brothers and sisters. And I feel for those who think they're going in a rapture, but they're not worthy. And I don't know if that bothers you sometimes, but it bothers me to know that there's some people out there who are thinking that they're saved, or thinking that they're gonna get raptured out of here, but they're doing something in their lives that's gonna get them left behind. So if there's any kind of sin in your life, if there's any one of the 12 commandments that you are breaking, If you are doing these things, then please, please, my brother or sister, please repent. Repent. Forgiveness can come as fast as you can get on your knees and ask for it, brothers and sisters. It's as easy as that, I think, to dropping down to your knees and saying, Lord, forgive me. And when you say it, mean it. I've noticed that a lot the last few years. You know, when you do something and you truly mean it, you know, that's when I see it meaning, like, taking effect more. That's how, when I gave my life to Jesus, when I truly meant it, that's when my life changed for the better. Remember, brothers and sisters, we're at the very last steps of this race before what we do now affects your whole eternity. Can you imagine that? This wouldn't even be the length of a nap compared to eternity. So basically, you blink your eyes, and then you're like, okay, this earthly experience was over. Now let me go spend my eternity off of what I did for that blink of a moment. Do you see what I'm saying? We are here, and once you truly are awakened to know, wait, Bible's true. Oh, wow, like, Jesus is real. God is real. And I can testify that Jesus is real. No, Bible's true, because I went to heaven and I've spoken with Jesus. So I know he's real because I have spoken to him face to face. So your next step would be getting yourself right and repenting and turning away from sin. Lastly, I'd like to invite everyone to get baptized by full submersion in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. For me personally, it was one of the best experiences that I've ever had. I gave my life to the Lord at 16 years old. I felt the Holy Spirit so strong at my baptism, and I want to sing for all of you. I love you all so very much, and I end this video in the name of Jesus Christ, right as another train horn goes off. I end this video in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Listen to me like you've never listened to me, ever in your life. We have got to lay our lives down for the purposes of God. This is not a Sunday school picnic, the Church of Jesus Christ. This is not an invitation to have continuous good times. This is a war for the souls of men. Come out from among them. Run for your life. Because this is about your life. It's not just about an opposing theology or a conflicting viewpoint on Jesus. This is about your life. My mind is forever branded with the story that I heard of police officers from the city of New York. As people were fleeing from a crumbling building, there were police officers and firemen and others that were running towards the building saying, run for your life, at their own peril. And in some cases, I believe they knew they were going to die, but there was a sense of duty. I was crying out to God. I said, God, oh Jesus, don't let my sense of duty be less for your kingdom than these beloved firemen and policemen were for those that are perishing in a falling tower. We're living in a generation when truth is falling into the streets. I want to be among those that are not running away from the conflict, but running into the conflict and saying, run for your life. Run from gospels that focus only on success and prosperity. Run! Run from those who use the name of Christ only for his personal gain. Run from those that are picking your pocket in the name of Jesus. Run! Run from gospels that only focus on self-improvement. Run! Run from churches where men and not Christ are glorified. Run! Run! Body of Christ, run! Get out! Don't touch the unclean thing! Run from churches in America and Canada where there is no Bible! There's no cross in the theology. There's no soul-searching word. There's no repentance from sin. There's no mention of the blood of Jesus. Run! It's unclean. Run! Run from churches where you're comfortable in your sins. If you come into the house of God and you've got sin in your life and you're not convicted of it, you're at a table of devils. Run from pulpits that are filled with political men who are using the pulpit of God for a personal political agenda. Run! Run from those who preach division between races and cultures. Run! Run! Get out! Turn it off! Get away from it! They know nothing of God. Run from ungodly, spasmodic movements and endless, empty prophesying. Beloved church, run for your life. Run from preachers that stand and tell stories and jokes. Run like you've never run before. Run! Run!
You've come in the final days.
All-knowing God has held you in reserve for nearly 6,000 years.
No mistake about it.
You are a marked generation. Earth at this particular time was full
of danger. God has saved for the final inning an army.
But you live in this.
You must be prepared to meet your God.
Youth of the noble birthright.
You're part of the Lord's royal army. The army.
There are things for each of you to do.
You will preserve
as well as your special
world.
You.
Me?